Good afternoon, everybody, and welcome back to this final plenary session. As you're all aware, we've had a very interesting product showcase outside this hall itself, and most of you have voted, and we have now got the final winners. So I'd now like to request Mr. Sanjay Mehta to please come onto the dais and hand over the felicitations certificate to these companies. So our winner today is Navya Lifecare. Request the Navya Lifecare team to please come up and give them a huge round of applause. Our first runner-up today is InfoKite Internet, maroon.ai. Can I request the team to please come up? Thank you so much. And our second runner-up for the day is Grey Kernel, the IRA VR. So congratulations to the winners and a huge round of applause for these products, all the product showcase companies, including the winners. I'm going to request Sanjay to please stay on the dais because we're going to invite him and the other speakers for our last panel. Request Linika to please come up and announce the speakers.
So we have our last plenary panel discussion, which is about investors envisioning the future. What am I getting better on today? Crystal grazing for creators of products, technologies, and ventures. Where are the big undiscovered opportunities that will create wealth over 5 to 10 years? Hear from the experts who are ready to back their predictions with hard cash. We have Sarbvir Singh, JPMorgan Private Market Advisor. Sashi Reddi, Founder and Managing Partner, SRI Capital, President TAI. Sanjay Mehta, Angel and PE Investor, Director, Core Media. Thank you. Ashish, Taneja, Managing Director, GrowX Ventures. Thanks.
Okay, hi everyone. I understand this is the last session, and I think we'll try and make it the best session on behalf of my panelists. Let me promise that. So I think, you know, the topic is relatively clear. You know, what are these big guys with lots of money betting on? And I thought, you know, before I, you know, hand over to start with Sashi, that, you know, let me set the context a little bit, because I think, you know, whenever we, I guess, come to conferences like this, you know, you detect this, there's a very visible feeling, right? A lot of the entrepreneurs feel that, you know, VCs don't invest enough, they're scared, you know, they don't do certain things, and, you know, they should be a lot more forthcoming with their capital than they really are. And, you know, I guess it's one of those things which is very difficult to, you know, solve for. But, you know, one thing I'd just like to say to all of you is that, you know, I've been sort of in and around this business for about 10 years now. And one of the most interesting things is that I think there has never been a better moment in India to raise capital than it is today. You know, despite what you hear about how there is a Series A funding crunch or whatever, you know, ET or Times of India wants to call it. But the truth is there has never been more capital available for India, whether you want to raise a lot of money, Series A, Series B, Series D, angels, everything. So I would say to you that, you know, the onus is really on you now, because a lot of these people have capital, they have to deploy it, it's their, you know, that's what they get paid for. So I think there is, you know, there is really no reason for them not to invest. So just with that brief kind of introduction, we are going to try and do this in two stages, about 35, 40 minutes of the panel, and then 15, 20 minutes for your questions. Two of the three panelists have to leave at 10 past 5, and one guy has an anniversary, so practically everyone has to leave. So we'll try and stick to the time limit. And so we'll start with Sashi and ask him what is he betting on today.
Okay, so firstly, I just changed my flight, so now I have like a lot of time. So once like the panel's over, if there's someone here wants to talk to me, I'd be happy to talk to you guys. And I saw a hand go up there. Thank you for that. Okay, so in terms of what I'm investing in, so to give you the background, last 2 years, I've been investing in enterprise software and deep tech. And the thesis was there'll be some great IP that's being created here. And I would try to find the right entrepreneurs that have that IP and help them take that to the US market. And that was the entire focus. And given that I'm a small fund, small team, I can't really spend the time to understand the technology. Firstly, I'm like too old for that. Secondly, like some of the stuff, it's very hard to tell why something is better than something else. So for example, you get a lot of startups that say that, you know, we are using AI or ML and, you know, this is what we're doing and we can do this at a better rate than someone else. It's very hard to tell. Even if someone could dig into the technology, it's very hard to tell what's really better or worse, in my opinion, and especially for a small fund like mine. So what I do is very, very simple. I just say, you know what, get three customers in the US that are using your technology. If it's paid, great. If it's not paid also, I don't care, but at least it should show that there's someone who wants to use it and it solves a real problem. So my entire approach has been that way, like, you know, enterprise software, deep tech, show me three US customers, and you know, and my typical like type of investment is maybe, well, 250K to up to like $1 million. That's a broad range of investments. So that is what I've been doing, and I think that there's still a big opportunity for me to keep investing in that area. In fact, I'm just doing one deal right now, which is in the augmented reality space. So what this guy is doing is he's building a platform like a WebEx for AR, meaning because right now all of the platforms out there is that they're all like really closed environments, meaning, you know, you have to be using either like the Google stuff or the Facebook stuff or whatever it is. It's sort of closed environment. But this is like a platform by which, you know, anyone with any headset could just plug in and they are able to enter into this space where they can actually collaborate with other people and so on and so forth. So that's an example of what I'm doing right now. Going forward, while I'll keep doing what I'm doing, I think there are some big opportunities that are going to be opened up here. So I'm actually now like really bullish about the Indian market. And I'd done a few of those before, but I had stopped doing the last couple of years. But right now, I think the environment is just right for some India-focused plays in like fintech and other types of areas that are going to be impacted by like the demonetization stuff. So I'm very excited about that area.
Okay. Thanks. Sanjay?
So I've been investing since last 5 years. And a couple of things learning from an investment thesis is three things. While I'll share what are my interest sectors for 2017, but my investment thesis has been, if I have to invest into any of the startups, the first thing what I would look across is, you know, is there money to be made? Which means, is the market size great enough? Is it rapidly growing? You know, so what's the opportunity like? So is there money to be made is something what I would like to see across. Secondly is, are these people who can make me money? Which means the team, you know, the domain expertise of the founder, what is their skin in the game? That's my second tick. The last one is how much money I can make, which means the deal terms, what value I'm coming into. So if I get this, typically these three answers right, then I would go across investing into the company. Basically prefer founders over markets and disruption over differentiation. So somebody who is telling that I'm a little cheaper and better does not excite me to look at the deals. Something which has got an unfair advantage where the IP can really withheld that moat is something what I would look upon. Specialize into B2B tech, but I've done across diverse set of investment from QSR to medical device across the board. Currently, what I'm looking across one is into blockchain and cryptocurrency. That's something which I'm very excited about, trying to find across startups which can really deliver purely on the tech side of it. Secondly, I'm looking across in home interior automation in terms of you know, how you can digitally you know, get those furniture inside the home, get the interior decoration done. I feel there is a huge opportunity to disrupt and, you know, the getting that broken system right with technology. Thirdly, I'm looking across in terms of health tech, very focusedly. I just closed a deal recently in health tech stuff, and I'm keen to do more deals in health tech area. While most of the pitches what I see across, entrepreneurs pitch platforms. For me, platforms is something which is a no-go. So all whatever you do across, be it AI, chatbots, you know, cognitive intelligence, you know, big data, I would look into a specific business use case, not into technology where I feel the technology is in hygiene. So what is that one problem which you are trying to solve for that industry for which a customer would pay you? That's what I would look into while I invest across. So would like to have specific expertise to back with funding. Have been part of multiple angel networks and have been building syndicates with family offices. So I've done one of the first largest round which I led across for around 42 crore in a fintech space with three family office. So while seed stage startups do happen, there are few with Series B kind of funding also which I've led across. That's
great. Thanks, Sanjay. Ashish.
Okay, so strangely, you know, the story is similar in terms of the sectors we pick or the opportunities we look at. Our focus over the last 4 years of investing has been a lot around deep tech enterprise companies, right? That's where we've seen maximum success for us, and that's where we've seen that we've been able to contribute to the scale-up journey, if you like, right? You know, we're fairly involved investors. We like to roll up our sleeves and, you know, get our hands dirty, and we've realized that, you know, we can really open up outside of money, your Rolodex, your smarts. You know, the real value is if you can help with the marketing engine, right? You know, open up doors and, you know, help put the entrepreneur in front of the decision maker to make sure you get real feedback and you get some real sales happening, right? So, you know, that's what we kind of focused on, right? You know, all of us, maybe Sashi and Sanjay, they've got more experience than us. We've been investing for 4 years. So technically, we're also a startup, right? So we're also learning. You know, and if someone asks me the question, what's your investment thesis? I think we've gone through multiple pivots or cycles in our own head, right? You know, from the time of saying that, you know, let's look at fundamentals. If a business can scale up to 100 crores of revenue in 3 years, or if there's a market large enough. So, you know, we kind of looked at those factors and, you know, we said, this is our thesis. Then one fine day, you know, I attended the Startup India session where Mr. Son, SoftBank chairman, was there. He said, I look in the eyes and I can invest. I said, here we go, let's go. So we also looked in the eyes and made a couple of investments. So, you know, what happens is that, you know, the reason I'm giving that perspective is, you know, as investors, you try to value your intuition, right? And, you know, Sanjay made the point, it's about founder over the market, right? So, you know, essentially you're backing the team, and that spark is what you look for in the entrepreneur. So, you know, that's a going in thesis when you kind of evaluate opportunities. You know, kind of back it up with your intelligence and your thesis and research to say, is the market large enough for a particular team to kind of penetrate and create a significant business, right? So, you know, we try to balance the two sides of the coin, if you like, and make sure we get the right deals, right? The question was, you know, 2017 onwards, you know, what are the sectors that are exciting for us, right? I expect, you know, we said we've done deep tech, and I'm going to throw again the same jargons you probably heard throughout. You know, I expect artificial intelligence, machine learning to continue to grow, right? But when we say AI and ML and all the other big words, it's more around finding practical use cases or applications for such technologies, right? And that's where we've seen the biggest success, right? You know, we've invested in multiple deals across different technologies, and we've seen a lot of value around that. And within the AI machine learning space, as an offshoot, I see the audio command, right? So, you know, what an Amazon Echo is doing or what a Google Home is doing, you know, that part of artificial intelligence to come up in a big way. The video aspect, you know, a lot of us are spending a fair bit of time on YouTube and capturing video, analytics and insights and ML and AI kind of supporting that around computer vision could be a enabler around that. So those enterprise layers, but with a clear use case, right? How can I make fashion more convenient? How can I make logistics more efficient? Enabling functions to make sure all the large enterprises which have been created, you're able to kind of make them more profitable, more relevant in the theme, right? Within sectors, health is a big area for us, right? And when I say health, we're not looking at the consumer internet side of it, right? Which is discover a doctor or book an appointment or deliver some medicines. We're looking at aspects around devices which can help you improve patient data or patient outcomes. We're looking at using data, using machine learning to improve stuff like prescription errors, stuff like medicine adherence, and so on and so forth. So making it relevant for the practitioners as well as for the patient, right? So within that, insurance could be a big element. So, you know, we're very keen on outcome-based health insurance as a market, right? You know, we've seen rushes of that in the US. We think the market, though, is still very small, but in India, we will see that, right? Insurance kind of takes me to the next sector, which is going to be huge, fintech, right? And within fintech, you know, we've seen a lot of work around lending, right? But we haven't seen anything around insurance tech. We haven't seen anything around blockchain-based attributes to kind of make that more system efficient. So we're kind of looking at those themes as well.
Okay, thanks. So maybe I'll come to Sanjay next. And, you know, since we have a room full of, I'm sure, many entrepreneurs in the audience, and you probably see many plans probably every week, is there, like, can you help distill a few things that common mistakes that you see from entrepreneurs when they pitch to you and things that you really like to hear? I mean, maybe give examples of both sides so that, you know, the audience can get a sense.
So maybe let me start with, you know, things which I would not invest into. So that would give you a perspective saying that what is, you know, this is my bias, my view. You will find many investors who would have different bias and different views. And first time no from an investor is not a permanent no that every entrepreneur should understand. So keep engaged with investors at various point in life cycles and you might get the right investor attention. So a couple of ideas which I don't or I think these are all passe and, you know, will not invest. One is anything which is related to discovery and listing. So let's say you are doing any discovery or listing. Those are the things typically are not going to fly off. Anything which is in horizontal commerce is something which investors will not look at it, or I will not look at it personally. While, you know, for example, chatbot, what we are talking today, there was a time era when, you know, first time we had chat started, internet chatting, right? At that point in time, there were numerous software companies which were providing chat. None of them have really made a business or a, you know, outcome out of just selling that chat feature. So idea is, unless you've got a business model aligned to the technology. So for example, a typical entrepreneur with a product will say that I built an 128-bit encryption. And for me as an investor, so what? It does not sound anything valuable unless you give me a specific business case. So I ask, so what? Then says it's very difficult to crack it. The next question which I have to ask, so what? What does it do? So then they will come out saying that, you know, it is very difficult to break in the communication between your office and the branch. Now that is where the customer will pay. So can you communicate your pitch in a way which is the business case where it is not, you are not building product, you are building a company. End of the day, it's a complete business which we would like to see into. We invest into business, not into product, not into technology. So can you show us that business vision which is going to work across? Many times we have seen across, you know, entrepreneurs just putting a spreadsheet with extrapolating saying that let's give a 30% growth month on month without applying any mind. So the way we will see a plan is on the day one when the funding is done across, we'll see 20 people team. Your hiring 20 people will take 3 to 6 months, right? So have you applied your mind going through? So when you send out a pitch, if you have not really lived through that week on week, month on month, then for us, it's very difficult to visualize how good, bad, ugly your business will be. So, you know, real life, practically living that business, working across. Secondly, you know, giving across that right customer use case is very, very important. You know, unless you give that customer use case, which explains investor. So while I'm coming from a tech background, I don't write quotes now, right? There was a time when that used to be the day job. For me to understand what's happening across, the best way is getting a use case learning. So if you can explain your product or technology with a use case and putting a value to that use case. So for example, this is what your product is doing. People are happy. But what did you save or make that with that product, earn that customer? Either it's a save or earn. What is that value creation which you are doing across for that? So if those specifics are, you know, made very clear, then I think it excites us to look at the deals.
Great. And Shashi, to you now, in, you know, you have a unique thing in sense you're looking at deals in the US, and now you said you're going to look at deals in India. What is kind of the difference that you see among entrepreneurs, you know, in terms of maturity or the way they present themselves in those, in both these two situations? And is there anything that, you know, maybe the audience can learn from each other? Is there something good that the US guys do or something good that the Indians do?
Actually, at this point, I don't see much of like a difference in the maturity of the entrepreneurs. Maybe that was true 4 or 5 years ago. I felt there was a big right. difference. But now I just find the entrepreneurs that I'm meeting here to be like really top-notch. I don't see any difference between the US entrepreneurs. In terms of... Well, go back to like the previous question.
Yeah, maybe you can go back second. To that one,
Like just listening to, you know, what you're saying, Sanjay, you know, all the stuff that you said, I think absolutely, like the way that I think about things as well. To that, I would just add like a couple of things about what I would look for in an entrepreneur, this thing. I think this notion of being all in for me is very, very important, because a lot of times, you know, when I see an entrepreneur saying that, you know, I want you as the investor to take a risk, and once you put that money in, I will then look at doing this and that, to me that's a big no-no, because why should I be all in you if you're not to be, we're going to be all in your own business. So I like to see entrepreneurs are like totally committed to making it happen. In fact, I would not be unhappy if they said that, you know what, I took out like a bit of a loan on my house to make sure that I can get this thing off to the next level. I would like to see commitment, because that's when I will get geared up, like to get behind that commitment. So I think that to me is very important, to be all in. The second thing is being able to the point that you are making, Sanjay, in terms of being able to really be able to get across what you're trying to do in a simple fashion. So, you know, what is the pain point that you're trying to solve? And I think sometimes it takes me like a second meeting to get to that point. And usually after that first meeting itself, I've already lost interest, because I can't spend the time to actually dig that information out of the entrepreneur. I'd like the entrepreneur to actually get across what is the pain point they're solving. And then, of course, how they solve it can have like all the jargon sort of thrown in there, and all of that's very good. So anyway, let me just stop there. I'm sort of wandering around. So.
Sure. So I guess, Ashish, everyone has been very politically correct, you know, in terms of saying that, you know, all these various points. You see a lot of entrepreneurs and business plans and stuff. I mean, give us some examples of things that, you know, like, you know, really ticked you off, or, you know, and vice versa, in terms of saying, you know, I love this guy, and I'm, you know, you looked into his or her eyes, and I'm assuming it's mostly her.
I haven't had that opportunity yet. I'm looking forward to that.
Okay, yeah. So,
you know, I want to just react to one of the questions you asked, Sashi, about the difference between a US entrepreneur and an Indian entrepreneur. I think the difference is huge, right? And there are a couple of aspects where we see a difference, right? You know, one is, you know, however you look at it, you know, you talk to a bunch of entrepreneurs outside of India, you see focus. You see a clear path, how to dig deep into a particular market, penetrate it well with a clear strategy. In India, it's, you know, we're like butterflies, you know, with that little mushrooming strategy, you know, chal cheeza kar dete hain, something will work. if this is not, this is failing, I'll move to another one, I'll do another thing. We don't see that discipline, that commitment, and that rigor to, you know, really go after a particular opportunity the way it's defined, right? It's changing, but, you know, we're still not there yet, right? And you listen to entrepreneurs outside, the stories, the way they present, the way they pitch, it's crystal clear. You know, to Sanjay's point around saying, you know, you make a like 128-bit encryption, I don't even understand what that is. And you're always asking us, so what, right? So you don't face that kind of challenge with most of the entrepreneurs there. You know, they're able to articulate the problem well, they're able to articulate the why and the what well, and, you know, with a clear strategy in terms of how they can really make an impact. And that's a learning for us, right? And that comes from, you know, how we get educated, you know, how we work, you know, the culture is such that, you know, it just kind of shows on that. So I think it's a huge difference, a lot to learn in that area. Coming back to, you know, the turn-ons and the turn-offs, you know, that's something. I think the biggest turn-off is, you know, when people, you know, use jargon just for the sake of doing. So, you know, here's a pitch. I've developed a platform using artificial intelligence and machine learning with an element of blockchain to make the world better. Right? Right, so you know, and you hear pitches. I'm kind of taking an extreme scenario, but you hear a lot of things that people say. You know, there are three guys saying that I want to do enterprise, I want to do deep tech, and there's AI, there's machine learning. Let me just plug these things in. And you know, once you can, you don't want to dig deeper in any of those starters. But if you know, you're sitting in front of someone, and I struggle at times to saying I've committed. I love to meet entrepreneurs, and I want to spend an hour, you know, focus on meetings because you know that's an opportunity for you to learn, right? And when you start like that, you tell yourself, you know, how do I get out of this, right? But you want to make sure you spend time. And the issue is the fundamentals are very weak. People don't think through how large the market is. They picked up an idea, reading some article, and just kind of replicating that, right? And I think that's the biggest turnoff, where you've kind of not done your research well. And I think the turn-on is exactly the flip side of it, right? You know, you sit here, and you don't have to ask questions, right? You just sit there like you're watching a movie, and, you know, that's been painted in front of you, and that's what makes you excited, right? And you know, and that's when you get the feeling that this guy's done the homework well, thought through the business quite well, made some initial traction, if you like, or spoken with a bunch of potential customers, got feedback. And I think that's what gets us excited, right? And at the end, you know, it's a relationship you're building in. You know, you go to offer something, and the entrepreneur brings in something on the table, and collectively you try to kind of create that, right? So. I'm not giving examples, but maybe I'll.
No, I have been very. So, so there was. I can share two pitches which I wanted to invest and lost across. So, there was one company called WizRocket, now it's called CleverTap. I started working with them and, you know, trying to build the deal, and Excel partner took them away. The first day when we saw the pitch, I said, this is what I would like to invest. Yeah. You know exactly that this is the deal you want to go after. And mind well, Excel did a seed stage round. Excel will never do a $1 million round. They did it just for the founders. The secondly was Haptic. I was working on that deal. Kalari took that away. So I lost that to VCs, right? So these are the kind of deals which you want to engage with. The day when you see those entrepreneurs, their product, their demo, that's where you want to invest across. So that's like, you know, huge turnouts.
So Ashish, like, just to go back to you, you know, you made this point about painting a movie or painting the picture. I mean, do you think that people who, you know, speak well, like I find that sometimes when you meet consultants, right, they are so slick, right? I mean, they have thought of all these things, they've painted the picture very well. But, you know, many times consultants are not, I mean, not to generalize, but are unable to execute because they're so good at, I mean, that's what they've been doing since they grew up,
sure,
right?
Sure, sure, absolutely.
So how do you counterbalance that issue? I mean, if somebody knows everything, then what's
left? Thoda dimag hum pe bhi hai. It's our, it's, you know, obviously, we're sitting in front of the entrepreneur trying to assess the venture, right? And multiple facts, aspects around that. It's our ability as well, right? At the end of it, it's our track record. You know, if you invest in 10 companies, if all 10 go belly up, clearly, you know how good an investor I am, right? As simple as that. So, you know, it's our ability to kind of ask the right questions, probe in the right way to make sure we get the meat out of it. You're right. The initial impression to say, you know, some of the consultants or some people who invest in banking, right, they're slick. They talk well, right? But that's fine. But, you know, after the first couple of minutes, you put that aside and you go into the business, into the depth of the idea, right? And if it appeals to you, that's when you kind of cut a check. But I seriously believe, you know, it's the same thing around saying, you know, what's your, do you have a branded college behind you, right? So, you know, are you from an Ivy League or the top notch thing? That opens doors, right? It's the same way, you know, have you worked with a leading consulting firm or a thing? It kind of opens doors. It kind of validates that, you know, this fellow's done something right, reached this particular point. So, but after the first few minutes, you kind of park that and you go straight into the fundamentals of the business. And if that's exciting enough, that's when you kind of check, right? And, you know, a lot of times it happens, there's a lot of guess.
I have a little disagreement in this. So I have a bias. I'll invest towards engineers more. Will not invest in chartered accountants, MBAs.
So it becomes difficult
because typically find it very difficult to engage with this set of people, and especially when software and mobile is eating the world, guys not coming with a tech background, very difficult to invest into startups.
So you know. Fair point. If you are focused on a tech-oriented startup, engineering is the core. You want to make sure that the core team's got that capability. But it's about a team, right? I don't think so. We've invested in 25-odd companies, looked at a few thousands. If you ask me out of my 25 companies, how many comes from Ivy League colleges or IITs or IIMs or whatever, I don't know that. Or how many are CAs, I don't know that, right? You know, you've done what you've done. Now we're sitting together to kind of create something there, right? And we've got to make sure the right theme and the right mix to kind of make use of their opportunity, as simple as that. So yeah, you're making an assessment that to build a product like this, yeah, do have the necessary capability, and we want that capability in the founding team. But I will probably be thinking aloud, if there are five engineers and coming out and solving that, I'll probably not invest in that. I say, where's the business acumen, right? Give me a balanced team to it, right? And you know, some engineers are great businessmen, some great business guys or accountants could be great product guys as well, right? You know, they are able to think through the market well. So you're looking at the balance. So education, degree is important, but not the core at the end.
I would just go a little bit further in the sense of I like tech founders, but I've personally not had much luck with a bunch of IIT guys. I think what happens is that they come with like certain entitled view. So the valuation is worse, like the terms are worse, their approach and attitude is worse in the sense of...
Blame it on Tiger.
Blame it on Tiger.
Yeah, well, if it fails, you know what, I can always get a job. So that, like the point I was making earlier, I like to see real commitment. And sometimes, you know, the guys who've got a lot to prove are willing to commit all in. So I actually like sometimes, in fact, some of the ones that I've had like really good success with, are guys who are not from IITs with strong Telugu accent or whatever it is. But what they want to do is very clear. They know what they're in it for. So
Hustlers.
Yeah, they just want to win. So I think I like the tech founders, but I don't like just going with the brands because that's never worked out for me personally.
So maybe switching tracks a little bit. I know we've heard a lot about sort of cutting edge stuff, right? Interestingly, the general view is that India is not the place for cutting edge technology. But today, you have three people who are really interested in, relatively cutting edge stuff. So maybe I'll start with Sanjay. Like, as you look at stuff in the blockchain, in an environment in India where, bitcoins and other cryptocurrencies very small, like how do you kind of look for these people and what are you really looking for? Is it a global kind of ability or, how do you?
No, there are quite a lot of local problems which can be solved with the tech side of it. It's just that. Are we getting deeper into this technology to solve a business use case? So for example, in altcoin space, there are 100 plus alternative coins to bitcoins.
Right.
None from India.
Yeah.
Right. You got across the globe, people have created coins for specific use, specific purpose, but we don't have anything in India. So we have challenges. While it's happy to feel good about saying that we have arrived, but we have not. So we are much behind in the scale what we can build across. What we are great or what we are good at doing is business models, operational businesses with tech enablement. Pure play tech, creating a platform. I've not seen companies really scale up and do really well. So from that engineering perspective, right, the product engineering, I think we have still yet to achieve more. But all this technology, be it blockchain, be it the AI, there are huge amount of use cases in India for enterprises. So I'm part of, let's say, CIO Angel Network. So they're all CIOs or buyers of IT which invest into startups. So these are the places where if you pitch across, you get free demo. So if some might be turn your customers, if your products are good, you get money even. So, you know, all this kind of value is available in India so that, you know, startups get access to enterprises. And sure. Enterprises are also started incubating. So, for example, we had one of the exits which just recently got published called InstaSafe, which is a cloud security software, which was acquired by a public listed software entity called IBM. Mm-hmm. So, idea is corporates are also started investing into sure. startups. So, both the things, the momentum has started.
And Sashi, in your experience, since you focus a lot, you said on enterprise software and stuff like that. How does, you know, again, traditionally in the US, there is a fairly vibrant market.
Actually, like I just want to comment on that. So, like in the deep tech stuff that you're talking about, that's why I don't put money into something that doesn't have like US customers. Because to me, yes, you have like all the various use cases in India, but I have no idea whether what's being applied to solve that is in fact like fully leveraging this deep tech stuff. So I'd like to see that same use case played out in the US, head-on competition with someone in the US and let this guy win there, then I would have the confidence that this is actually a... So, which is exactly why, you know, like my filters are like that. I just say that, you know what, show me three US customers using this stuff, because until then I don't know whether it's deep tech or something like nice that's nice to have, but it's not been really tested against someone who knows what they're doing and can actually check it. So.
But doesn't that kind of limit the, because then you are basically, you know, doesn't that limit the number of people you kind of would work with?
Yeah, which is actually fine because I get about, say, like 5 plans a day when I've been doing, so that's like a good volume. So, right. But with this filter, it still is going to come down to like a couple of week that I talk to. So, that's right. Enough deal flow.
Sure. Can you share some names in your portfolio just so that people get a sense of, you know, what are the kind of companies you backed and how they've done?
So, for example, I put money into a company called... Phenom people, so this is not deep tech, this is like enterprise software. So these guys came up with a new approach like for doing recruitment. So they have something like a social recruitment platform. And so right now, say that you want to apply for a job, you just send like a resume to somebody, it goes into some queue and then someone's going to process it and all that stuff. What these guys do is that when someone wants to apply for a job, they actually engage with that person by giving them like the right information that they need to see them through that application process. So for example, if you're like a big hospital trying to recruit like few nurses, these people don't have time to look and apply for jobs. But through this platform, they're able to dramatically increase the number of these specialized roles that they're able to fill in that hospital. So that's an example. So these guys, when I first came in, they were doing about 30,000 per month, 30,000 MRR. And within 12 months, they'd gone to about only 100K. Then they raised like Series A. Now they are at about 750K a month. So that's an example of one where it just great market, great founders. Found these guys are like hardcore, and I saw them when they were really up against the wall, not prepared to give up. They had to whatever sacrifice they had to make, they made it, and saw it through. So you know, so those are the types of entrepreneurs, and you just see it that they will not let go until they win, and that is really what I look for. And of course, the exact market doesn't really make much of a difference because finally, I think like we're all betting on entrepreneurs. The market is sort of like secondary to the whole thing. So. Yeah, so that's an example of one which
sure. Ashish, you want to add anything?
So, you know, one of the questions you asked, I think, Sashi, about how do you evaluate cutting-edge technology, right? And, you know, we early-stage investors, which essentially means that we have to take early bets, right? And not on all occasions you have the fortune of having a few clients signed up or the technology tested and everything. You really have to spend time with the entrepreneur to do that, right? So I'll give an example. Early 2015, we invested in a company called Mad Street Den, Chennai-based, working on artificial intelligence, computer vision technologies, and multiple other things, right? When they reached out, they said, you know, they're looking to create a platform of various, let's say, AI tools to focus on mid-sized enterprises, right? And they said, you know, Google can do it on their own, Facebook can do it on their own, but a Flipkart can't, a Shopclues can't, and a lot of the mid-tier e-commerce companies that's in the US can't, right? And we said, you know, sounds possible and probable, and you know, let's just spend some time. And you know, I remember we ended up spending maybe 4 months just researching the idea, right? We said, we don't understand artificial intelligence. That was the first bet. We scanned through our network and we ended up reaching out to a guy called Dilip George, who runs a startup called Vicarious out of the Bay Area. And if you look up Dilip George, he's best known for cracking the CAPTCHA, right? So using his AI. If you look at Vicarious, you know, if you see his 50 investors, the who's who in the Silicon Valley has invested $1 million in that company, right? That's how well-respected, well-known he was in that field. He happened to be a batchmate at IIT of my partner, and we said, hey, Dilip, you've got to help us understand AI and everything. And when we went to him, we didn't even know what questions to ask, right? So, you know, we're saying artificial intelligence. He said, what is that? We said, we don't know, right? And, you know, with him, we kind of learned, spent time. And, you know, the second interview was much better. The third interview was much better. Over 3-4 months, we kind of developed the thesis, and we said, yes, this is the company we want to back. The good thing was that none of the VCs or early-stage investors in the country, they were also in the same boat, but they didn't have the time or the ability to deep dive and, you know, spend the kind of time we had. So, you know, we had the fortune to kind of go out and, you know, do our research, do our thinking, and take a bet, right? Earlier, last year, Sequoia did the Series A. You know, they now moved to the US market, they're building it up.
I had seen the deal, I didn't do it.
Right. So, you know, because people didn't have the time. We said, you know, this is our job, right? And, you know, for want of a better thing, you know, over time, what you develop is you develop bigger balls, right? And, you know, you start with tiny little things, you don't know what it is, you make some bold bets, you just keep getting more and more confident in that. So research is very, very important, right? But 2015 or 2016, we probably wouldn't have that opportunity at 3 months leeway to research a deal. It was madness, right? But now the times are decent again from an investor perspective where we can do our research and do that. And that's how we get better as investors. We have to be ahead of the entrepreneurs to a great extent to kind of see that. So, you know, we spend a fair bit of time evaluating companies, thinking through what could be the next themes, and, you know, taking calls on that, right?
Okay. Yeah. So I think we've kind of reached a natural break point, and maybe we can open it up to questions and then see where we end up. Yeah, please. Please give us your name also. It's okay, you have a loud voice.
Yeah. Go ahead. My name is Anant. I'm the co-founder of a company called Verbum.ai. We have a predictive analytics platform for B2B marketers. My question to everybody in this panel, and would love to hear from all of you, is for a company in the enterprise space focused on the B2B sector at an early stage, would you suggest we focus on validating the product locally first, or, you know, expanding and finding a global fitment and then coming back to it? And how do the investors view that kind of a problem?
If you got money, go global. If not, start local.
And you know, Sashi's already said 3 clients in the valley, so it's a very clear answer.
I would start local,
yes.
Because for like dirt cheap, you can get the thing proved out. Like they may not pay you, but you can get it proved out, and then you can get your 3 customers in the US come to me for money.
I agree with Sashi. You know, you guys are based out of here. You understand this market well. In B2B, we have the opportunity to improve the product, to evolve the product. It's best to kind of go local, demonstrate success, you know, demonstrate that the product works, it creates value, and then go out of the Bay Area, right? So, you know, a lot of people come in, they, you know, they say they want to start in the US with no network, with no real sales team to kind of penetrate into this market. It just wastes of money and effort, right? You won't see success unless you are goddamn lucky, as simple as that. You know, sitting here, this is where the team is, focus here, build a product before you kind of venture out.
Yeah, and yeah. You know, I'll give an example which I was personally involved with, which he also mentioned, you know, CleverTap. So if you see what they did early on was that they actually worked with BookMyShow to actually create a platform which BookMyShow used as gratis, you know, for their marketing.
And that's a demo we showed.
Yeah, and then, you know, they were able to go to various people. And you know, one of the reasons why Axel invested, frankly, was also because they were investors in BookMyShow. Mm. So, you know, it creates this very powerful validation. you know, not always can you get such a good reference customer, but it creates a very powerful validation. And while they didn't make any money necessarily from that engagement, I think it's paid off in, you know, in spades for them.
And see, again, Sunil was from US.
Yeah.
You know, the founder were, as it is, the rock star founders, right?
That's Anand, true. Yeah,
both Anand created good. Burp.
Yeah.
So
yeah, absolutely. Yeah, please.
My name is Ranjan Swami. I'm founder of CompuJack Systems. We have a compliance solution.
One of the things many people have told me is that I should first test a few customers on my platform, make sure I get some paying customers, and then go for either marketing using my own funds or using marketing, raise fund for marketing. Now, I've got a customer, but that customer is basically a service provider who's giving me 200 customers. So will that be counted for me as that I have got the validation of enough people to go ahead and start in the market, or should I actually get 3 or 4 more independent customers to be able to be comfortable and say, okay, yes, I should go for, I've got the customer feedback, the customers are paying, I should now go for expansion.
Is your end customer using your product?
Yes.
Then it's more than a way, what channel, use omni-channel, whether it's a disti, somebody using dealer, network, whatever. End customer has to be using your product on a regular. What's your daily user engagement is the most important part.
There are two usage. Like one is going to be a power user, and it's going to be a management user. So basically, I'm selling the both the platform through a service provider. I'm only selling part of it to the 200 customers. So they're not getting the flavor of the entire product. The entire product flavor is only given to one customer who is using as a power user, and then management of the 200 customers are viewing their compliances through the dashboards. So for me to say whether I've got 200 customers will not be fair because I haven't given the flavor of the entire product.
So don't say that.
So you
who is telling you to say if you don't feel fair?
No, I think to be fair to him, I think his question is that he has this one user who has 200.
I would say he needs more than one power user,
I think.
So multiple.
Who's the contract users? With? Is it with the service provider or with the end customer?
With the service provider.
That's one customer.
Yeah. One customer. Okay.
And I just want to, sure. You know, it's not about one customer or five customers. Mm. Early on, what we're trying to do is get feedback from the customers to make our product better. Right.
That's
the more engaging your clients are, the more the better access you have, you know, that's how your product will get richer.
Sure.
So evaluate from that perspective that you're getting feedback from multiple people who are using a particular product to kind of make it more efficient.
So Microsoft had IBM as one customer, but then it was Microsoft.
Yeah.
Right. So what are the end clients is what you need to look at.
Sure. Thanks.
Hi, my name is Vikas. I'm representing Xperia Technologies. A question to the panel is, how do you see the crowdfunding framework evolving in India?
There are enough and more startups which are there. Personally, would I invest into something where I've not met founder or worked across? Very limited. Chances are negligible unless that founder has got some pedigree and a public face.
The question is not from the perspective of you investing in a crowdfunding thing. The crowdfunding as a platform for raising money.
Right. So I would not invest into startups which are showcased in the crowdfunding. So because I've not interacted with founder, didn't have a face time, for difficult to understand.
But do you hold that against them, or are you just saying that if they were to approach you directly you would discuss with them?
So for example, in an angel network, there is a lead investor. So you back those lead investors.
Sure.
Somebody is going to work hard, and you back those lead investors, and you follow across. Even if you have not met the entrepreneur, somebody in your network has done it. That's how cumulative intelligence of angel networks are built.
Right.
I would just add that if you used, say, like the Kickstarter type thing to get like some early traction for your product, that would make it attractive, actually. Kickstarter sales.
So just want to add on to this. I think two things. One is on the regulatory stuff. I expect things to change. You know, recently there was a SEBI guidelines around crowdfunding, not the right way of to raise capital for your startup. And I think course of this year, next year, we will see a fair bit of changes to enable that, which essentially means it's a legit platform for an entrepreneur to go out and raise capital. It's a different issue if Sanjay or Sashi decides not to invest, but there could be thousands others, right? if you look outside of India, right? So, you know, AngelList, our crowd based in Israel, Republic, these three are fairly large platforms, right? You know, they got tens of thousands of investors, and they mobilize, you know, hundreds of millions of dollars for
even
a lot of
venture.
Companies.
Even Let's Venture.
Right? So, you know, Let's Venture based out of India, right? So it's a platform that works, and, you know, people have demonstrated that outside of India. And a matter of time that regulations will be more open for someone to kind of do it in a better way. Yeah?
Okay. Anyone else?
I think we are sorted.
Yeah. So, Suvinder, anything from you? No? Okay, well, thank you. You guys have been a great audience and a great panel. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Ravi.
Thank you very much. That has been quite a scintillating session, and I think lots of people would have derived some great tips from all of you. Just a little momentum of our appreciation. So, Subinder, request you to please hand over a little token from our side. Thank you so much. A huge round of applause for all these gentlemen, please. Thank you very much, everybody. I hope you've had a great day, a day of networking, of sharing, and of learning. And I'm sure you would have, you know, networked with your peers, too. Look forward to seeing you in our next NPC. Thank you very much, and good night.